Okay, good evening. We will do a combination of a few different lectures because I see different levels. You know, when I go to a place that it's all beginners, then I give lectures about proofs, like we give in a seminars. And sometimes I go to places that almost everyone is Shomer Shabbat. They already go to learn Torah, so they need different kind of lecture. Here it's a mixture of everything. I try to give a mix of everything, if the kids will allow us, so you can hear me. And also we speak a little bit about the situation. Situation in Israel, the situation in America, the situation is in the world. We are in the most difficult time we've been in a long, long time. When we can see that for those who are familiar with the Torah and the prophets, everything that is happening now in the world is already predicted 2,500 years ago by the Nevi'im, by the prophets. And also the Gemara told us, the Gemara gave signs what's going to happen before the world will mature to receive Mashiach. For 2,000 years we dream about Mashiach, we dream about Mashiach. Some people already started to think that Mashiach is a myth. It's a fairy tale, something that the Jews invented to have hope. So maybe it's really nothing like this. It's very easy to get fooled by it, but if you really invest 5 minutes of your time and you check the sources in the Torah, in the Tanakh, in the Bible, you have no doubts that Mashiach for sure will come. And there will be a tremendous revolutions in the world, all over the world, what's going to happen in those days. One of the signs that the Gemara says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Hashem Yitbarach, God will bring every person in a creation to realize that everything that he has, he got a free gift from God. Nothing is thanks to him. There are many, many successful people in business. There are many educated people. There are many talented athletes, musicians, all kinds of successful people in the world which walk around all their life thinking, I'm such a talent. I invested time in learning. Thanks to my strength and my ability, I became so wealthy, I became so successful. I'm the most handsome guy, I'm the prettiest girl. All this nonsense that people sometimes think that it's thanks to them, they will be forced eventually to realize that everything he has, it's really not his. He's only a visitor here, it's only temporary here. That Hashem will educate especially the Jews to realize that really the materialistic life that they love so much is the last thing that he's interested in. He's not interested. It's very interested because if you heard about a few years ago, it's already more than 15 years, that they found there's a way to communicate with autistic kids through the computer. Because an autistic kid is mute and deaf, he cannot communicate with you. Sometimes it's Down syndrome, sometimes it's babies. It can be 2 years old autistic babies laying in his crib. They're able to communicate with him by bringing his hand into the board and he clicks sentences. When in reality, it can take you 5 years to teach him to say one sentence. You have to repeat it from morning to night. You want to teach him to say one sentence, 3 words. Take years for him to realize because his brain is not working. But in reality, when you bring his hand, even 2 years old, into the board and he begins to type, then you see that his soul is able to communicate to you with no limitation, no problem. The first thing that they said, when they started to give information in the last few years, soon only the educated people will survive. Nobody understood. The Goyim in Australia, in New Zealand, in England, where they deal with autistic kids, they really developed this. They didn't understand what does it mean, soon only the educated will survive. This is one of the things the Gemara says. The Gemara says in the time of Mashiach, it's like a pregnancy of a woman. 9 months of suffering. It starts very, you know, a little bit throwing up here and there. You know, it's a little bit difficult in the first 3 months. I don't feel good, I'm sick, I'm not in a mood. Okay. Then once it gets to the last month, it becomes really bad. Some of them cannot move from bed. the last day of the pregnancy, then the contractions begins. In the beginning is every half an hour, then every 20 minutes, then every 10 minutes, every minute, every 10 seconds, until the last 10, 20 minutes of the labor, it's mamash hell. It cannot be any more pain than this. A woman is screaming, cursing, sending her husband out of the room, I don't want to see you, she cursed the whole world. A minute later, after she hugs the baby, she doesn't even remember what's going on. But the suffering, the pain, drives a person so crazy, he can curse his own father and mother, even though he loves them very much. He doesn't realize from the pain. The Gemara say, this is exactly what's going to happen to the people in the days of Mashiach. It's going to be a situation that God is choking the people more and more and more. Choke and choke them even more and more until the people will get down on their knees. Lefanav ichreu, that's what it says. Everyone will bow down on their knees and say, God, we have no more questions. We realize, okay, please, no more. It's enough. We surrender. Until now, what are you talking to me about God? You know, I'm so successful. I do business. I fly first class. I have a yacht. I have a house. I have another building. I go to shows. No problem. We keep Shabbat. We eat kosher, you know. Try to be honest in a business. Not that it's possible, but we try. You know, we do all these things, but we don't want to be fanatic like these people. They sit and learn throughout their life. It's a different world, Rabbi. We are very modern. Modern. We'll get to a point that not only the modern or the non-religious Jews, even the goyim, that's what we say in a prayer, we don't know what we say. This is what it means. The whole world will realize there's one God, one truth, one future, no two, no J.C. Penney, not Muhammad, none of this nonsense. The Jews will not have to fight with the Arabs. The Arab will burn their own mosques. Those who will survive, the righteous ones. Why? From the embarrassment. And the Christians, forget it. They won't know where to show their face from the nonsense in their book. If you saw the debate I had with a Christian professor, I don't know if you heard about it, I had a 3 hours argument with a priest in front of a large crowd. We had more than 1 million people who saw it in the internet. Every day, I get at least one email from a goy that wants to convert and he left the church. Every day, sometimes 3, 4, 10, but for sure one. I wonder what's going to be the surprise today. Why? They already realized by seeing it that their book is full of mistakes, full of errors. Quran, I brought you DVDs here, if you saw a bunch of DVDs, yeah, right here. The first hour, it shows what the difference between Judaism to all the other religions and cults. How many religions and cults we have in the world? 80,000. More than 80,000. Just in America alone, you have 10,000 religions. Everybody claims he has the truth. Well, the Christians, billions of dollars they donate to the church because they believe it's the house of God. What for? Why they go there on Sunday? They pray, they stand, they sacrifice all kinds of things from their life. Because they really believe. The Muslims, look what they do. They jump into the fire, they kill their babies, they live like dogs. Why? What for? They believe this is what God wants from them. They brainwash them in a mosque, and they believe this is the right way. If you watch this DVD, even a goy, if he's intelligent a little bit, and he's honest, he won't be able to look at them and spit at them one more second of his life. Why? Their book, it's in a level of a first grade Jewish boy. You take a boy from yeshiva, first grade, tell him, I want you to fake a book that we can claim that God gave it to us. Fake one. A Jewish kid, first grade in yeshiva, will fake the book much better than them. Such a bad fake. It's so obvious that it's not the word of God. But believe it or not, 4 billion people follow it. And give a lot for it, especially the Muslims. Look what we're going through. All the problems we have in Israel is because of this fake book. If this book wouldn't be there, we wouldn't have all these problems. They would be satisfied with the Middle East. They have the whole Middle East. What do you care? So there's a little 5 million Jews. They have a little piece of land the size of Queens and Brooklyn. What's the problem? It's all about religion. This book drove them crazy. When in reality, this book says such stupid mistakes. that it shows you that the person who wrote it didn't know 1% of the Torah. Because remember, they admit that the Torah is the word of God. They just claim that God gave them another book. And right there, it's the problem. Because once you claim that the Torah is the word of God, and he gave Muhammad, he nominated him to be another prophet, and he gave him another book, then the book that he got has to comply with the book that the Jews have. It's part one, part two, or part one, part two, part three. It doesn't matter. It's the same one who gave it. And then you, when you read in the Torah certain things, and you read what their book says, hard to believe. Very not knowledgeable person wrote it. But this is what we're facing to. The Gemara says, one of the signs before Mashiach will come, that all the people will become rude. No patience one for another. People are arrogant. People are angry all the time. They don't have patience for everything. Not for their wives, not for their children, not for their brothers, not for their customers, not for the people on the bus, honking, going crazy. Pnei ador ki pnei kelev. People will behave more like dogs than like human beings. Now remember, you may say, all right, no, so I don't think it's a great prophecy. It is a great prophecy. Why? Because in the time that the Chazal wrote it, 2,000 years ago, the people 2,000 years ago were very, very far from the level of the people today. The Goyim, the non-Jews, were very modest. No women were able to walk naked on the street 2,000 years ago. If a woman would show her knees, it would be the end of her career. Nobody would want to marry her. Nobody would want to spit at her. Nobody would want to be around her. Just if she picked up her skirt, read a little bit history book of the Goyim. How they used to be. Rashi writes 900 years ago. Rashi, 900 years ago only. He writes, all the Goyot are virgin. They do other sins. But they won't allow themselves to make a sin that they're not going to be able to get married. This was in Europe, not Arab countries. Arab countries until today it's like this almost. Just giving you an idea, the world went far away from the truth. Very far. You know how it is when you aim a tank and you want to shoot the target, it's enough you make a mistake by 1% in the ankle of the bomb, of the missile that you shoot. You made a mistake by 1%. The more it flies, the more it's far away from the target. If it's only from here to 100 yards, it can still hit the building because it didn't fly that much. But if it's miles away, the more it continues, the far away it comes from the building. The building is here, it goes all the way there. Why? Because it's very far. We are after 2,000 years. People, not one person in the world today knows the purpose of life. Nobody knows what they live for. You go ask people on the street, tell me, what's the purpose of life? Why God made such a world? Why he made people here? Why he gave us intelligence to control the animals? Why we have the ability to talk, to read? What are we doing here? What's going to be afterlife? What is it, the Torah? The answer to all these questions are in this DVD, in a very nice way, with music and some films and movies, with scientific proof, that even a monkey that will watch this DVD will become a kosher Jew. Why? Can argue. The facts is one by one, scientific arguments, nobody can argue with. I had these arguments with the top people you can think of. I even had an argument with the controller of the state of New York. All the money of New York State was in his hand, Alan Avesi, if you know him. I had an argument with him in front of public group, large group, were watching the arguments. And then after the lecture, he said, I'm almost convinced. I still have some questions. I said, let's go and sit together and continue the arguments. We went to dinner. By the end of the dinner, another 2.5 hours, he said, that's it. Very easy to prove. 2-3 hours. And this is a clever person, not just a politician, because he was a professor for history. He knows a lot. Because all his life, he taught in universities history before he became a politician. He knew a lot. And he's very clever, but still cannot argue with the facts. The question is, he didn't have luck. He's now 68 years old. Go and change your life in this age. You found out that all your life was a big mistake. It's very difficult. A Jew didn't know what he lives for. Politics, success. Most Jews don't really know what they live for. Goyim, forget about it. They don't have Torah. But most Jews, you go to Israel, ask all the Israelis, Tel Aviv, Hulon, Bat Yam, on the beach, what is the purpose of life? To enjoy the sun, to enjoy food, to make business, to make a lot of money, to try to be healthy, to raise children, to get married, everyone has another, to do sport, to sleep. Nobody really knows. If that's the purpose of life, God would make you a monkey. If the purpose of life is to enjoy the sun, you could be a monkey. You don't need to be a genius human being. Be a monkey. The purpose of life is to swim, you'll be a fish. To play basketball, you'll be a monkey. To run fast, you'll be a lion. I don't know, a tiger. What does he need to have children? It'll make you a monkey. They also have children. To have relation with ladies, to enjoy, be a monkey, they also enjoy. To enjoy food, be a dog. He rips the garbage, he eats whatever he likes, he doesn't suffer that it's left over. Chinese, Italian, you know, every day, different menu, for free. Doesn't have to work 30 years to pay the mortgage, no IRS, no January, no April 15, none of this headache, no doctors, no this, no divorce, no fighting for the kids, none of these things. Get up in the morning, jump on the trees, eat good, swim. Very nice. Have 5 different wives. Doesn't have to put a show that she like him, doesn't like him. Mamash, animals. Live in a Bronx zoo, they take care of you, they bring you the meat right into your mouth. You lay there on the rock. You not worry. How many people will give 90% of their wealth to buy one thing? What is it? That I will never worry about anything in my life. My mind will be clean. I will be relaxed. I won't have stress. I won't be worried about the future. It's going to be my daughter. Who's going to marry her? Who's going to marry my son? How I'm going to make the wedding? How my partner? How I'm going to get rid of him? How I'm going to buy the business? Somebody made it. All this worry that a person has, he doesn't enjoy 1 minute of his life. From what his worry, what's going to be? Now business is bad. How many stores we're going to have to close? What are we going to do? We have a bill coming up. How am I going to pay the mortgage? Would she agree to my shidduch? How much I'm going to have to give the shatran? So many things people worry. They don't have 1 minute of rest. Will I make it to the meeting? Will I be able to open the stores? Will they call me to the army? You know how many Israelis now in this month will lose their career? After so many years they invested in college and in business, 1-2 months you're out of the business, you're out. That's finished. Everything you build went to the garbage. Thousands. Tens of thousands. Reserve. Think about it. You have a store in Manhattan, you pay $30,000 rent, you have employees, everything. You're not in a business 2 months, they steal everything. They rob you, they do whatever they do. By the time you come back from the army somewhere, you lost millions of dollars. 20 years of investment went to the garbage. Why it's happening to us? Open Parashat Bechukotai, a full explanation why the situation with the Arab in Israel is the way it is. Mamash, 100%. God already told us, if you're not going to listen to my laws and my Torah, this is what I'm going to do to you. What? I will not protect you from the enemies. The enemies among you will become greater and greater, and you will go lower and lower. You're going to shrink into the center of your country and give up parts of it. Mamash, word by word. Exactly the way it happened in the last 20 years. You won't have peace. You won't have rest. You won't have a peace of mind. There's no peace in the land. They run after you with a sword. Even when nothing happened, you're scared. Mamash, a complete problem. It couldn't be more precise. Holocaust. What's the most famous question of the atheist Jew? Or the anti-religious Jew, I should say. What's the most question? Which excuse they are using to go against the Torah and against God? Number one excuse. There are a few excuses. Number one, where was God in the Holocaust? That's the most famous question. Question number two, if God knows the future, how come I have a free choice? I'm a robot. It's not in my hand. What do you want from me? God already knew if I'm be righteous or wicked, no? So what are you telling me? Try to be righteous, keep Shabbat, come to learn Torah. It's all known already. Whatever's supposed to happen will happen. This is the excuses they make. Nonsense. If God made you a robot, why did he bother to give you Torah bechlal? Be careful. You should not do. You should not kill. You should not rape. You should not eat not kosher. You should give tzedakah. You should be generous. You should be merciful. What all this nonsense? You're a robot. You're a machine. A bunch of aluminum and plastic. Someone is moving you with remote control. You tell your robot, hey, be careful. You should be merciful. You should be generous. Well, you're talking to the wall. Why? What is the Torah? 90% of the Torah, you should be careful, you should not, all this restriction. You don't give the wall Torah. The wall cannot make sins. If you have a computer, the computer can make sins. Forget about computer. If you have a dog makes sins. Nobody ever put a tiger in jail that is a murderer. He murders zebra every day. Nobody puts him in prison because they know it's not in his lives by instinct. Why a person that kills goes to jail? Because every fool knows he's not a robot. If he wanted, he wouldn't be a murderer. It was up to him. Before we even get to religion. But when it comes to keep religion, everybody becomes a wise guy. God already know my end. When he made me, already knew what's going to be out of me. That's why it doesn't matter. Excuses. Why people give excuses all the time? Because they must relax their conscience. Because God made in a system of a person a warning light. And the warning is already bothered the person all the time. When a person just did something wrong, he feels bad about it. But once he repeated second time, he doesn't feel as bad as the first time. Third and fourth and fifth time, the warning doesn't work anymore. The conscience is dead. He got used to it. Person that killed the first victim, he doesn't sleep a week after. He gets nervous, he cannot eat breakfast, he goes around, he looks himself in the mirror, or even cry. Goes, maybe a week he doesn't come to work. It's a shock. I just killed someone. Second time he killed a person, no. Third time, fourth time he's already looking in the newspaper if they need a hitman. For $5,000 they'll kill anyone you want. They don't have. He just killed and he smoked his cigar. Look at the Nazis. They used to take babies, put them inside the oven, and what they used to say, Dunkenschön. Take a little boy, 5 months old, throw him inside the gas. No problem. Then later on, he comes, he hugged the dog. Mamash, unbelievable. Like machines. Why? The conscience is dead already. You understand? So the point is that a person must relax his conscience. It bothers him. So he begins to lie to himself. It's like a guy that goes to the mechanic. He say, what's the problem with the car? The check engine light is blinking. He say, oh, the engine is dead, finished. How much to fix? $10,000. Doesn't pay. The car doesn't work $10,000. So he say, but the mechanic say, okay, I have a way to make it, the light goes away. $5. Come back in 10 minutes. He cuts the wire. The guy comes, no light? Ah. 3 days later, he called AAA at 1 o'clock at night, freezing weather. I'm stuck there on the highway. There's 2 hours until they show up. You talk to them, he doesn't answer you, this guy. You know how it is. Why? You wanted to relax your conscience, but the reality doesn't change. One guy in Israel, he was driving a truck that, you know, he moves cement. You know those special trucks that turns around and they create cement and they make sidewalks and cobblestone. So he is living in a private house in Israel. It's a real story. He lives in a private house and, you know, it's hard to park this truck. You have to go in a wild circle, you know, you make a turn, a wide turn, and you go right into your parking. So if the cars that park, like in Brooklyn, you know, they made the driveways too close one to another. If one car try to park, it's always going to block the it's hard to make a turn. It's very, very crowded here. So this guy gets very angry if someone parks right by the entrance. So he always warns the neighbors in the building next to him, nobody parks too close to you that I can make the turn. And everybody knows this guy is crazy, he's very, very angry. You don't mess with him. He cut your tire, one time he comes, believe it or not, someone had the nerve to park a brand new car inside his driveway. No parking. You see a brand new car inside my parkway. He said, I'm going to teach this guy a lesson like never before. He goes in reverse. He opens up the cement. All the cement on the brand new car. And not only that, he made sure he covered it from all the sides. He cannot open the door by mistake. The car is now full of cement. Now he relaxed. I took revenge on this chatzuf. He goes inside the house. He says, wow, the house is dark. He turned the lights on. Everybody in his house, cousin, uncle, surprise! His son comes dead. 4 years anniversary. Here is the car, the brand new car we bought for you. This is us. We do things, we don't realize what we do. He got lucky, he saw the reaction, the results of what he did a minute later. Some of us will only see it 60 years later. Two Russians drunk, they sitting and playing chess. So they play chess, they drink vodka, it's very cold night. Their job is to make sure nobody touch this button. There's a button on the wall, red button. Security, danger, nobody touched. They're guarding the button over there. Once they drank a few bottles over there, one guy tells the others, this is nonsense. What are we wasting time? I can prove to you that I'm going to press it myself and nothing will happen. You want a bet? The guy says, yeah, let's make a bet. He pressed the button, nothing happened. See, I told you, nothing happened. 10 minutes later, sirens, people run. Running inside. What happened? They play chess. He said, don't you realize what you just did? What did I do? 50 million people die across the river over there. You just shot an atomic missile to a place, and over there everyone is dead, everyone is going crazy. The person is turning a cigarette, lighting a cigarette on Shabbat. What happened? Rabbi, what's the problem? Nobody realized. Why? Ignorance. Only one word can explain it. I don't want to say evilness, because I really didn't meet that many evil people. Even angry people doesn't mean they're evil. One guy told me, Rabbi, I'm only angry when people making me angry. I have a reason to be angry. I'm not just angry like this. I'm angry when people make me angry. I told him, you're such a fool. If a person is angry just when he's alone in the house for no reason, then he needs a mental case. Everyone gets angry when someone makes them angry. What's so special about it? Oh, I'm only angry when people make me angry. So what do you want? You want to be home all day sitting like this and then go and break the glasses because you got angry for nothing? The point is, a person lights a cigarette. He turns his car on Shabbat. What does he think? In the old days, it was very difficult to make fire. You know, you have to go, you have to bring rocks, you make spark, it takes you half an hour, he has to catch the oil. Finally, you made fire. Hashem didn't want you to waste an hour every time you want to make fire on Shabbat. You need to rest on Shabbat. So, that's why it's not allowed. What do you say about this? Makes sense, no? This is the most ridiculous and stupid comments that a person can make in his lifetime. Why? If he only wastes 10 seconds of his time to learn a little bit history, he would know that 2,000-3,000 years ago there was no electric. And everyone lived in houses that were made from wood or from cement or tents. And what happened is they needed light. How do you make light in a house? You take buckets of oil, you put fire, like we do in Shabbos candle with the olive oil. You have on the shelf or inside the wall, they made holes and they put lots of oil with fire, and that's how you have light. You have all the time you have fire. You never have to go make sparks. You want fire, you take from here and you light here. Always have. You cannot afford not to have fire. You need it because you want to cook. You need it because you want to light the woods to make heat in the house. You always need fire. You don't have a minute in your life that you don't have fire ready for you. And this is not allowed on Shabbat, to take from this and bring it over here. You didn't sweat. It didn't work. So this idea of rubbing two stones together, somebody made it and everybody jumped on it. Wow, it's a good excuse. Ignorance. How many people knows that in the eyes of God to be mechalel Shabbat is even worse than to kill people. How many people knows? Not even one I met. I never met a Jew that doesn't know Torah. Those who know Torah and learn a lot, they know it. They don't have the guts to tell it to the people, because then the people will never invite them again. Nobody wants to hear the truth. But according to the Torah, the Ten Commandments, Mechalel Shabbat comes before you should not kill. It goes from the most important to the less important. The punishment of Mechalel Shabbat in the Torah is much worse than the punishment of a murderer. The restriction against Mechalel Shabbat is much worse than the restriction against a murderer. A murderer, a mafia guy that keeps Shabbat, big gangster, kill everyday people. But he shomer Shabbat, you can give him any aliyah on Shabbat, no problem. He can be a witness. He can sign on your ketubah as a witness, you are married. Mechalel Shabbat, sign on your ketubah, you're not married. People don't know it. How do I know that they don't know it? Because most of the people, when I show them the difference, they get the shock of their life. Where were you 10 years ago? I wish I knew it. They didn't know. They think, Shabbat is a day to rest. What's the best way to take a person that doesn't believe in anything and make him religious? What do you think? Just tell him life is beautiful for religious people? It's not going to work. Hey, I'm not religious and I love my life. I have a wife, I have children, I have a nice house, I have two cars, I have a yacht, I have businesses, I have people working for me, I get a lot of respect. I can do whatever I want, I sleep until whatever I want, I'm healthy, I enjoy music, I go all the time, I play golf. What do you want? I couldn't have a better life. I live much better than you, leave me alone. You know, it's not an argument. He thinks he lives better. What's the best way to take a non-believer and make him in 1 hour a complete believer? What? All you have to do is to focus on proving to him that the Torah is a divine book. That's all. If you're successful in 1 hour to show him this book can never be written by a human being, all you have to do, take 10 minutes extra in the end of the proofs, and show him some of the things that Sefer Dvarim says about a wicked Jew. Wicked doesn't mean evil. Wicked means a person that violates the rules of this book. That's what it means, wicked. You show him what God said about people who listen to him, and you show him what God says about people who don't listen to him, and you leave him alone. Is that an indication that tomorrow he's going to become a rabbi? No. Perhaps he's going to go back to his business. 2-3 days later, he's going to drive again on Shabbat. But there's only one difference. Now, before you spoke to him, every accident he's going to have in his life, what is he going to think? Bad luck. Bad timing. I wish I wouldn't leave the house 5 minutes later. I got into this traffic because this has happened to me, because I'm too soft, because I gave up, because I didn't learn enough. All kinds of things. Because I listened to my wife. My partner is a fool. Why should I listen to him? It's all an illusion. He thinks it's all coincidence. So when he loses money, he hits his heart. Bad luck. Why me? Bad luck. He's aggravated. He doesn't believe there's a hand who moves everything around. Such supervision about every person. Every step he makes, Hashem is watching him carefully. You cannot move an inch. You cannot make anything before Hashem will approve it. You want to hurt your friend? If he doesn't deserve it, nothing can happen to him. You'll never be successful. In the Holocaust, 400 Jews were able to escape from Germany to England before the camps. In the beginning, they escaped to England. The Nazis never occupied England. They had a big war with them. But they were able to be in England until the British, they started to suspect maybe this is German spies. Why should we take risk with them? Let's get rid of them. So what did they do to them? They put them on a boat and shipped them directly to Australia. So go to Australia, be over there. So they took their suitcases, their money, their jewelry, whatever they had, and they went to Australia. One thing they did, they sent them with sailors that just came out of jail. people that came out of jail, they were trying to find them a job. What did they find them a job? Ship boats in the ocean. Nobody wants this job. They give it to them. These people anyway hated Jews, these British that came out of jail. They're criminals to begin with. What did they do? They made a plan to rob the Jews and take away everything they have. So what did they do? They stole everything they have, everything. Whatever they didn't want, they threw into the water. Suitcases, clothes, things. They threw everything into the water. They left them with nothing. Nothing. In the meantime, they got to Australia. They threw them out of the boat. Think about it. 400 Jews, after what they went through, they arrived to Australia. They don't have a penny in their pocket. Nothing. No food. No, nothing. They stay there over there in Australia, and they have to start. They go, they sleep on the benches in the park. They knock on doors. There's no Jews there over there at that time. Nobody to talk to, nothing. Just like this. In the meantime, they took the boats and they go back to England now. 40 years later, they found a diary of a German officer, SS officer. They begin to read this diary. It described the entire war, where he was serving, and they found out that he was a commander of a submarine, German submarine. And he writes, in this date, I was on a mission with my submarine between England to Australia. It was a boat that was coming from England towards Australia, British boat, and we got an order to shoot 3 missiles and destroy the boat. Remember, this is 60 years ago, so it wasn't sophisticated like today. The radar only show you stains on the screen. See a stain, you know there's a boat. We shot 3 missiles, we don't know if we hit them or not. So, how do we know? We look at the screen. If after we shot the missile, a few minutes later, we see stains on the water, that means the boat is crushed to pieces. It goes all over the water, so you see a lot of stains. If you have one big stain, it's a boat. If you have 20 or 30, that means the boat is now 30 different pieces. That's how we know. And we shot that boat, and we were sure that we destroyed them. But after a week, we saw that the boat coming now from Australia to England. And we realized that we actually didn't shoot them. So this time we shot them, and we went all the way with the submarine to make sure that we killed them. This is the story. What confused them? The suitcases. They threw 400 or 800 suitcases. They were all over the water. When they shot it, after that they checked, they saw the suitcases, they got confused. So the Jews got saved. They never knew. They went to Australia without a penny in their pocket. But if you ask them before, what do you prefer? To get a missile in your face, or to lose 5,000, 10,000, whatever they had in their pockets with your clothes? What would they say? Take everything, just don't touch me, right? I'll manage. Finally, many of them became very rich in Australia over the years. A person never know what he got saved from. He never know what he should have had. The nature of a person is always to complain about what he doesn't have. That's what Chazal says. Yesh lo maneh, rotzeh matayim. He has 100. He seeks for 200. 200, he goes for the 400. 400, he goes for the 800. Therefore, since he always runs for a lot, the more he has, the hungrier he gets. Why? A person that had $2,000. His psychology is, if I will have 4, I'll be such a happy guy. If I'll make 4, I'll be very happy. So he's missing 2,000. Person that has 2 million, his dream is to make it 4. How much he miss? 2 million, not 2,000. Who is more miserable? A guy that needs another 2 million. He's dying for it. Kills himself. There's no end to this. A person is never relaxed. He never say, you know what? I don't care. I put a little efforts in my life. I go to work a few hours a day. I'm not going to kill myself. I'm not going to fly. I'm not going to give up my life with my family, with my wife, with my children, with my learning. This comes before everything. God has no limitation. If he wants to give me money, he'll give it to me in 3-4 hours that I work a day. I don't have to work 12 hours a day, kill myself. Yes, naturally it shows that I make a lot more money when I work many hours. But nobody guarantees that this money will stay by me in the end of the year. there's a lot of unexpected problems. This problem, the accountant made mistake, the IRS called him, he had to buy a car, somebody said, I know a Syrian guy here, he bought a car, brand new car, a lot of money. He said, I'm tired, I'll call the insurance tomorrow. Put it in his driveway, temporary plates. By the morning he came, the car is gone. Almost $100,000 he lost. He made a lot of money that year, but he had some incidents that year. In the end of the year, he didn't make anything. He needed to borrow a few $1,000s. And he made a lot of money. But there was no bracha in this money, no blessing in this money. Parnasa doesn't mean how much you make. Parnasa means how much you have left in your pocket, in your hand, in the end of the year. Let's give you an example how you prove to a person that the Torah is divine. How do you know? How can you prove a person that this was not written by the rabbis? Here you go. I'll give you an example. We have a mitzvah in the Torah. I'm sure some of you heard about it. It's a mitzvah of red cow. You heard about red cow? Para Aduma. What's so special about this mitzvah? What's so special about this mitzvah? When the Torah says, if a Kohen is impure, he touched a dead body, or he went to a cemetery, he walked over a grave, not knowing it's a grave, he went to a hospital and someone just died there, someone died in his home, someone died in a place where he was, he became tameh, impure. How do you make this Kohen pure? Very, very long and complicated process. First, you need to have a red cow. What does it mean, a red cow? Like this chair. It's all red. You don't find black stains, brown, white, nothing. All red. But it's not enough. If a farmer today will have a red cow, he wake up in the morning and he see a red cow, he become a billionaire right away. The Jews will collect as much as money as he asked for it. We don't have a choice. We had 9 red cows in the history. The Torah said it will be 10. So there will be only one last one. And that's for the third temple that we're expecting to build instead of that golden mask over there. We have one more red cow and we're going to all depend on that red cow because we're all impure, all of us. So what happened now? If a person had a red cow, it's not enough. He has to know the rule that you cannot put any weight on the back of the cow. If a person didn't know, he had a red cow, and he just leaned on it, like this, with his elbow. He went like this, on a red cow, that's it. The $1 billion became $5,000. He became a regular cow, finished. He put one bag in the back of the cow, or he sat on it, finished. One of his kids climbed on the cow, it's over. Torah say para aduma shelo ala aleha ol. No weight was ever put on it. Can we understand this rule? Doesn't make any sense. To begin with, almost none of the mitzvot in Judaism makes sense in the human logic. And if you're clever, you don't need more than that. Right away you realize if 80% of the mitzvot in this book are against human logic, that means this is a divine logic. I have no way to understand this. No human being was able to make such laws. Who would make such laws? For what? To make himself look like crazy? What liar would write a phony book like this and try to convince the people to become religious according to this book when 80% of these laws are against human logic? To clean the house for breadcrumbs. What for? To get rid of the mother bird from the nest and take the chicks away. What for? To stand with a lulav like this. To sit in a sukkah. You have a $10 million house, you sit outside in a $1,000 sukkah for a week. Well, it doesn't make sense. To put a box here, nobody can think about the logic here. Why? It's way above our understanding. Torah says, "Ki lo machshevotai machshevotechem." My thoughts and your thoughts are not the same. Don't try to understand everything I tell you. And my ways are not your way. My way compared to your way is like comparing between heaven and earth. Or the eagle to the worm on the floor. That's the comparison between your ways and my ways. The way you're functioning and the way I am. So, right away you see, for sure a person wouldn't make these weird laws, because there's not even one thinking, one thought to think that somebody made up these phony rules. A person wouldn't think about it. And if a person will make such laws, the people will kill him after 10 minutes. Because he become a very annoying threat. You're bringing me this book and you want to destroy my life? You're telling me to divorce my wife because she's my aunt? What do you care? I marry my father's sister. She's younger than me. Until now it was allowed. Now you're giving me Torah and you tell me you have to get divorced? What about my 10 children? You tell me to throw all the cars I prepare for the Shavuos holiday, to throw them to the garbage because I slaughter them with a knife that is not 100% smooth? Doesn't make sense. Nobody would agree. Why everybody agree? Because inside the Torah it says why. Because everybody heard God speaking to Moshe. If they wouldn't hear it, nobody would accept it. So what is the secret about red cow? Just to give you an idea, how can you prove scientifically to a person that it's divine? The Torah says if you had weight on it, it's obsolete, it's worthless. Comes the Midrash, which is the Oral Torah, and this is right in front of you if you understand. And this is what it says. The Jews didn't know if they're allowed to buy a red cow from a goy or not. Why? What's the problem? The red cow from the goy is a different red cow? No. What's the problem? Maybe the goy sat on it, and only later he found out that you're not allowed to sit on it. Now what do you think? He's going to tell you, yeah, I sat on it? If he's going to tell you, yeah, I sat on it, the 5 billion became 5,000. You lose a lot of money. What do you expect him to tell you the truth? He say, I pretend I play dumb. Nobody will know. I won't tell them that I used it to put some weight on the back of it. And the Jews will buy it from me, and I become rich. How would we know? We cannot trust his word. It's not a fair witness. So the Torah says, don't worry. You can buy a red cow from a goy. You shouldn't worry about it. Why? Here is the story. The Torah says, Ma'aseh shenitztarchu Israel lepara aduma. The nation of Israel needed a red cow. They're looking all over. They're asking the goyim, Texas, here, there. Hey, you have maybe a red cow? Ve'matzu etzel goy echad. They found it by one goy. They told him, sell us the cow. He said, 4 coins of gold. Let's say $4,000. Okay, $4,000. The Jews take out $4,000 and they say, okay, here. The goy started to think, if the Jews don't argue on a price, something is fishy. Doesn't make sense. Usually 4, they slash me right away to 2. So he said, okay, you can come tomorrow, we'll finalize the deal. That's how it was. He goes to his neighbor. Richie goes to Vinny. Hey, Vinny, what's going on here? The Jews came, they hot, they want to buy this cow right away. They took out the money. What's so special about that? It's red? Say, you fool, this worth fortune, this cow. You're the luckiest guy. Any price you tell them, they'll pay for it. But you have to make sure they don't see you leaning on the cow or putting your hand on it or putting anything, because if you do it, they won't buy it from you. Now the goy is not so crazy about the Jews. So what did he say? I'm going to teach them a lesson. I'll put weight on it all night. The morning when they come, I'll give it to them. I play dumb. I'll get a lot of money and we'll see. When the Jews come back, he told them, hey, the price is not 4. I want 5. Okay. 6. Okay. 10. Okay. 20. Okay. All day like this, negotiating, it went up to 1,000 instead of 4 coins, 1,000 coins of gold, out of money. So, by the end of the arguments, the Jews told him, is it the final price? He said, yes, final price. Say, okay, let us go and bring you the money. They go back to the treasury of Beit HaMikdash, they bring 1,000 coins of gold, big bag, and they come right there. And they put the money on the table, and the goy is so much gold. And so, all right. And guess what? The Jews say, okay, don't touch the money yet. Let's check one thing. They come to the face of the cow. One rabbi is looking at the cow like this, goes like this. The other rabbi takes a magnifying glass He goes to the neck of the cow, and he goes like this, back and forth, check it. Then the rabbi tell him, you go make fun at your mother next time. No deal. They take all the coins of gold, they turn around and they go. This is right here in front of you, the story. I'm just translating it. Go make fun at your mother. Fool somebody else. They go, hey, come back, what's going on? You put weight on it. They told him. We don't buy it. The Gemara say, he goes inside his house, he take a rope, he put it on a roof, and he hanged himself, and before he killed himself, he say, bless you, the one that chose these people to be yours. He choked himself and he died. That's the story. Why the Gemara bring a story? What is this? Story for children? There's a big secret here. What's the secret? How did the rabbis know that he put weight? The Torah say, God says, everything I created, every order that I gave you, you need two witnesses for it. Two signs. What are the two signs that red cow is kosher or not? If you put weight on the back of it, anything you put on it, the eyes of the red cow become cross-eyed. It will never be straight again like before. Cannot do it. That's it. Or another sign, there are two hairs in the neck that once you put weight on the back of the cow, those two hairs are falling down. And you try to raise them back up, impossible. They're always going to fall down after a second or two. You cannot raise them to stand like it was. It falls down. And that's a sign that somebody put weight on the back of this cow. So the rabbi was looking for this, and he found it. He saw it's down. And the other rabbi saw it's cross-eyed. He said, you put weight. Yesterday was good. Now it's not good. No deal. And I want to ask you a question. For those wise people that claim, rabbi, the Torah is from the Chachamim. Moshe Rabbeinu wrote it, and every rabbi came and added another part to it. Oh, who knows who wrote it? We don't know. What human being was able to even dream in his mind that a cow, from millions of hair that the cow has, two of them in somewhere in a body are exceptional. They're different than all the others. How would he know it? How would he know to look for it? A person is in a world now, he see a world, he see cows. One day out of nowhere he's thinking, you know what, this cow is special. There's two hairs somewhere in the body. How would he even make a connection between weight to the hair that they fall? This is all divine information. Nobody could know such a thing. How would he know to check in the eyes that it became cross-eyed a second after you leaned on the cow? What's the connection? There is no way in the world to know such a thing unless if the creator of the cow told you that secret. No other way. This is just one out of 1,000 proofs that I show. You can see some of it in the video here. I'll give you one more example. You don't need more than that. But one more example. The renewal of the moon. The renewal of the moon. What's the renewal of the moon? NASA measured for many, many years how long it takes to the moon to renew itself. The cycle of the moon is approximately a month, but they went to 10,000 of a second. That's how precise it is. Cost them a lot of money, thousands of employees, spaceships, mega computers, everything. And guess what? After NASA found out the renewal of the moon, I can show it to you that it was always in the Torah way before them. And this is how it goes. According to the Torah, Pesach has to be in the spring. The Torah called Pesach the holiday of the spring, Chag Aviv. But we have a big problem. Because the year of the sun and the year of the moon is not the same. There's 11 days difference. 11 days difference. 354 days is the moon. 365 is the sun. 11 days difference. So the Muslims, they don't care. They go by the moon. The Ramadan moves every few years from the summer to the winter, the summer to the winter. No problem. Christians, they saw there's a problem in the calendar. Every 4 years, they have February 29th. February is 28 days. Every 4 years they push a day to balance it. Jews have a big problem because the Jews go by the sun and the moon. How did the Jews overcome the problem of 11 days? God told Moshe, this is how you overcome the problems. Every 19-year cycle, you push 7 extra months into the calendar, which means every 2 or 3 years, we have an extra month in the Jewish calendar. Adar Aleph, Adar Bet. 2 Adar. The second Adar we push right before Pesach, before Nisan. Why? Because if we wouldn't push it, Pesach would fall in a freezing weather. A month before April, in the beginning of March. That's already still freezing. Even in Israel, it's cold, very cold. So, you push another month, you postpone Pesach by another month. Oh, spring. Then you wait 2 or 3 years, it goes down again, you push another month, it goes up, back up. This is how you move it, month back and forth. And that's every 19th, the Christian and the Hebrew dates fall in the same date. The 19th, the 19th. Yud Bet, the 12th. Every 19 years. So, why we have to do it? Because if Pesach will be in the winter, this is the first mistake in the Torah. It cannot be divine. The Torah say, Pesach Chag Aviv. What Aviv? In December. Pesach is in December. It's over. The Torah is finished. If the Torah is finished, you don't have to keep Shabbat. You don't have to put tefillin. What are you wasting time on learning Torah? It shows that it's not divine. Because if it's divine, why God made a mistake? He called it Chag Aviv. Why? It's a mistake in the Torah. So the Torah, Hashem say, in order for you not to make a mistake, to think that I made a mistake, I'm teaching you the trick. Okay. The Gemara says, remember, there was no Jewish calendar yet. Every time the moon was renewed, 2 witnesses had to come and tell to the rabbis in the court, we just saw the renewal of the moon. The rabbis announced on Shabbat in a shul, this week, the Rosh Chodesh has to be around Tuesday evening. Around 5:30, around that time. So people were standing on the mountains. Once they see the renewal of the moon, they run down to the court, they testified, they get a prize, they sit with the Chachamim and make a big meal with all the big Rabbanim, and that's how it used to be. And now from there they count. 10 days, Yom Kippur. 14 days in Nisan, Pesach. It was all manually. Now, the Gemara say, pay attention to this, it's mamash amazing. 200 witnesses came to Rabban Gamliel. Not 2, 200. The Torah said 2, it's enough. Listen to them. 200 came, they told him, Rabbi, we saw the renewal of the moon right now. When? 5:21. The rabbi say, you're all wrong. It's a cloudy day, you got confused. They say, what do you mean? He say, I'm telling you, you're wrong. He say, why?
Why?
Because En chidusha shel levana, the renewal of the moon can never be less than 29 days and a half and 2/3 of the hour and 73 parts of the minute. 29 days, we all know what 29 days, right? And a half, what's half a day? 12 hours. 2/3 of the hours, it's 40 minutes. 73 parts of the minute, you have to break the minutes, 73 parts. The number is 29.53059. This is the exact time it takes, the minimal cycle of the moon could never be less than this. It can never be 29.53057. It cannot be, because the Torah said this is it. Now remember, this is 5 digits after the decimal point. 1/10,000 of a second preciseness. And this is what NASA says. Here is NASA. This is the original copy from NASA, Earth Moon System. 29.530588. This is NASA. What did the Gemara say? 590. 2/10,000 of a second difference. Take a second, break it to 10,000 pieces, take 2 out. What is it? This is the difference between the Americans and the Gemara. But the Germans, they make better car because they're Yekes. And they are always more precise than the Americans. And in 1965 in Berlin, the Germans did their own research. And guess what? They found 29.530589. 1/10,000 of a second. And someone told me about a year ago that they upgraded it to the exact number of the Gemara. Whether they did or not, it doesn't matter. This is the question. Do you know a human being 3,300 years ago that was able to know that the renewal of the moon after all the movements in the galaxies and everything and all the stars, with what did he measure it? With his watch? There's no watch. With his little calculator? There's no calculator. Satellite? How do you know? There's no way to know. Don't, no way to know the renewal of the moon. Well, how you can measure it? There's no way to measure 5 digits after the decimal points. What do you see? Divine information. Right next to it, it says, Habibi, you have to keep my Shabbat. It's an agreement between me and you for eternity that you belong to me. You don't want, no problem. Don't come to complain later on that I cut you out permanently. Where does it say it? We say it in a Kiddush. Why we say in a Kiddush? How many Jews make Kiddush and a minute later they turn the television on? Why? Not that they're evil. They never thought. They never used their head. 5 minutes of concentration and thinking, they couldn't look at themselves in a mirror for the rest of their life from the embarrassment. What they just did. Ignorance. They never think. They never learn. They do things all their life. Not once in their life he was stopping to think, what am I doing to myself? One day I'm going to have to pay such a tremendous price for this foolishness. But when a person doesn't know, he doesn't even have to be what to be afraid of. I'll give you an example. What a Jew says in a Kiddush. Millions of people say it. 2 or 3 million people, not always they think about what they say. Veshamru bnei Israel et haShabbat. And the nation of Israel observed the Sabbath. What? La'asot et haShabbat ledorotam brit olam. To make Shabbat for their generations an eternal covenant. Strong words here, it's not a joke. An eternal agreement, eternal, eternity, forever, for trillions of years, it's not even the beginning. An eternal covenant between who and who, what's the rest? Beini uven bnei Israel, ot ile olam. Between me and the nation of Israel, it's a sign for eternity that I made the world in 6 days and in the 7th day I rested. You want to be like me? I created you in my spiritual image, not in my image of the face. I don't have a face, nose, eyes. It's all metaphoric words that the Torah used. The hand of Hashem, the eyes of Hashem. It doesn't have any image. It's all spiritual. I made you the Jew, Yitzchak, Avraham, Yosef, my son. And you spit in my face? This is what you're giving me in return? No, I'm not interested. I want to be Ahmed. I want to be Mustafa. That's what you want. That's what the Jew says. Not intentionally. But who cares intentionally not? This is what he does. And he cut himself permanently out of this covenant. And that's why the Gemara says, Mechalel Shabbat, Areu kegoy lechol davar. En lo chelek la'olam haba. He has no part to the world to come. Why, Rabbi? I'm a Jew. My mother is Miriam. She's Jewish. One time, my wife brought 2 tickets to a show. You know the Rainbow Room in Manhattan? Rainbow Room in the CBS building, in Rockefeller Center. There's a fancy building over there. They made a show on the roof of there. There's a beautiful club, everything glass, round. You see the entire Manhattan. Huh?
They closed down.
Baruch Hashem. There's no more fancy people.
They just announced like 2-3 weeks ago, I heard in the news.
So that's going to be for their memory. Le'ilui nishmatam. So Rainbow Room, maybe Hashem saw I'm using this story in my lecture, he got angry. So you know what, let's wipe them up. Who knows? Anyway, she brought 2 tickets. She used to work for Miller and Berkowitz, selling fairs, fair coats. She used to work for them many years ago. Somebody, one of the clients, you know, people buy fair coats, they have connections, so they gave her 2 tickets. Now, I don't know the singer over there. But, you know, a Jew here that he got now $350 ticket true, what is he going to do? He's going to leave it on a shelf. And an hour or two before the show, there's nobody to find to sell it to. So you know what, let's go see what it is. We get there. You know, the way we dress, casual, you know. We come, big shot, I show him the guard, I show him the ticket. He goes like this. He has a little flashlight, he look at the ticket, check like this, looks at me, look at her. I see the guy is not happy that we came. Then while I'm there for 2 minutes, I see all these limos and the Rolls Royce are coming, they open up the door, all these old people with the tuxedos coming in. And I started to realize, maybe I came to the wrong place. But I'm already there, what do I care? I want to get in, I have a ticket. So I said to the guy, any problem? He said, well, yeah, I cannot let you in. I said, why you can't let me in? He said, even though you have a ticket, you didn't read the back of the ticket. I said, what do you mean? He said, here, look, no jeans, no leather jacket, no sneakers, no cigarettes, no this, no this. At least the Ten Commandments of the Rainbow Room. It's true you have a ticket, but you did not fulfill your requirements. I can't let you in. What's the message from this story? Every Jew has a part to the world to come. Kol Israel yesh lahem chelek. A Jew has a share to the world to come. What's the rest of the Mishnah? And those are the Jews that have no parts to the world to come. What do you mean? You just say every Jew has a part to the world to come. Yes. It's all conditional. One of the conditions is to keep my agreements, my covenant. You do it, your ticket is valid. You don't do it, you lost your ticket. You can have a ticket. Your mother is a Jew. You were born with a ticket. But what can I do? You didn't keep Shabbat. You didn't put a tefillin. You worship idols. You charge interest from another Jew. You stole every day in the business. I cannot let you in. Very sorry. Just imagine the disappointment of a person when he gets to this point and he says, I'm sorry. You cannot enter. What about the tzedakah I gave? I paid you for that. When? You had 3 houses? What do you think? Just like this, I choose people and give them 3 houses? Most people in the world cannot pay the rent. You had 3 mansions? It was a joke. I pay you for all the tzedakah you gave. I gave you a beautiful wife. This is for this mitzvah. 3 children is for that mitzvah. Money in a business from this mitzvah. The police let you go the other day. It's for this mitzvah. He gives him a show, a report. This is what you did, and this is what I paid you. But I owe you nothing. And the righteous Jew that had tough life, everything hard, no money, no health, cancer, problems, doctors, running to the yeshiva, his wife is worried, there's no rent for tomorrow, where are we going to feed the children? We don't have money for Shabbat, tomorrow it's holiday, let's call the rabbi, maybe he can help us out. People feel bad for them. What's the bottom line? They didn't get the reward yet, that's why they're like this. Where does it say in the Torah that righteous people, Hashem loves them and He keeps the reward to the afterlife? And wicked people are getting paid in this life. Who knows? Where is the source? Maybe the rabbi made it up. Where does it say in the Torah, mamash clearly, without a slice of a doubt? Parashat Vayetchanan, the last 3 sentences in the Torah, Parashat Vayetchanan, in case you had doubt, I'll show it to you right in front of your face here. Where does it say in the Torah that chas v'chalila, if a Jew doesn't live by the Torah and is successful, he is the most miserable person on earth? Why? Because I didn't make the rules, but this is what the Torah says. Look, I'll show you right here. Here you go. You see, Devarim, Zvarim Zayin, Parashat Vayetchanan. This is the last word of the parasha. So from Tet to the end. You should know today that your God is the faithful God who keeps His covenant and the kindness to His lovers, to those who keep His mitzvot. for 1,000 generations. How? We only live one. One here. The real life begins in the time of the death. What do you think? Soul separates from the body. Now the reward begins. And pay his haters. Who? You know one person in the world that hates God? I never met. I know people that don't keep Shabbat. Yeah, I know people who don't keep Torah. But a person that say I hate God, maybe once or twice I heard. Maybe. Maybe. You don't really see it. You go to the Arabs. You know any Arab in the world who say I hate God? You know any Christian that will say I hate God? I never hear this. Even Jews, they don't say I hate God. I don't believe in him. I don't want to listen to him. It's too difficult for me. I'm disappointed for me. Fine, but I hate him. I really didn't see. But the Torah says, I pay my haters, those who hate me, cash to their face to get rid of them, to destroy them. I will not delay my haters. I will pay them cash. Why? I don't want to owe them a second. Take what I owe you now, that I don't have to see your face after life ever again. Why? Here it's temporary. You want to enjoy this world? You don't know the purpose of life? No problem. I'll pay you here. That's what you want. That's what you get. When you come there, you are naked. You have no savings, no nothing. And this is it. That's what we learn from here. Let's analyze it. Those who hate God, who are the ones who hate him? Those who don't listen to him. If you don't listen to me, right away you are in a category of my enemies. I still give you oxygen. I still give you money to put gas in your car. I still give you air condition. I still give you a beautiful wife. I still pay for everything you have. I make you successful in your business. Your heart is working 75, 80 years. I still do all this for you. But that's a part of my payment to the few mitzvot you are doing every week. What is the few mitzvot? Here you put a dollar. Here you make agreement, peace between husband and wife. You respect your father. You brought your mother after your father died to live by you. You took care of her. You give her some tea. You brought a doctor for her. Every Jew makes mitzvot, even if he's not religious. For the little that he does, he gets paid in this life. How do you know if God loves you? He punch you nonstop. He kick you. He slap you. Every day you get a new punch. That's a sign that God loves you. Where? What, I'm crazy? Sounds crazy. With the Torah, you don't argue. The Torah says, Et asher yohav Hashem yayasro. Someone that I love, I'm tough with. Very simple. Here. Oops. Oh, yeah, I spilled a little bit here. Someone that I love. No, it's okay. It's no big deal. Okay, no problem. Someone that I love. Thank you. Someone that I love, I'm strict with. Where does it say in the Torah? Ve'yadata bilvavcha, you should know in your heart. Ka'asher ye'yaser ish et bno, the same way a father is strict with his son, kach Hashem elokecha miyasreka. This is how I'm your God is strict with you. Tickets, towing, bankruptcy, heart attack, problems, divorce, all these problems. Why? Wake up, my son. You suffer here 20, 30 years, don't worry about it. It's a blink of the eye, it's over. As long as you don't have to suffer after for eternity. That's the point. What's better, to enjoy 20, 30 years and then suffer forever? That's the truth. I know people don't like to hear it. Nobody likes to hear the truth. But what can we do? Can we change it? Can we avoid it? Okay, you know what? Keep me out of the game. Not interested. Leave me alone. Not interested. Oh, if we had a way to press escape, I wouldn't be here. What do I need to come for months here giving you all these words? If there was a way out, why should I waste time? No problem. When a person becomes sent, it's over. He doesn't get reward, but he doesn't feel anything. It's over. There's no Gehenom, no suffering, no Gilgulim, no reincarnation, none of these things. Then you know what? You're right. You don't want to pass the test. God says giving you a test. What happened? Chabal Yom Hashem. A lot of. No siman tov. Huh? Ma'amayim. Yeah. So God says, I want you to pass my test. Ki menase Hashem etchem. What does it mean? I am testing you. What for? What are you testing me for? To see what's in your heart. Will you listen to me and keep my mitzvot or not? What for? Okay, no, you're testing me. Then what for? What's the purpose of all these tests? Lehativcha b'acharitecha. To reward you in your end. Where is that end, Hashem? Not here. Don't be a fool. If I wanted to reward you here, I would make you a chimpanzee. He has a much better life than you. Everything you're dreaming about, he has from the moment he's born. 2 minutes after she gave birth to the baby played basketball. She ran around, no diapers, no 20 years of suffering, doctors, vaccine, changing diapers, waking up in the middle of the night. None of this. You saw the deer? You saw the deers, no? How they born? 2 minutes later, they run. The tiger comes, he just born. An hour later, he runs. Don't have any problems. 3 years to pay mortgage? College, 7, 8 years? To make $50,000 a year? To work 10 years to pay the college loans? Wow. They don't have this, all the animals. How much he has to put that this female will like him? Buy her drinks, buy her this, give her that, give her a credit card, beg her, come again, send her messengers. In the end, she agreed, give her a kiss on the cheek. The monkey is born, 2 minutes later, he has 5 different wives for free. They eat good. They're not worried. You ever saw a monkey with gray hair? They never have it. You saw an animal with stress? Psychiatrist, psychologist? 1 out of 7 people in the world is depressed on Prozac and other anti-depression medication. 1 out of 8 women in the world have breast cancer. Did you know that? Put 8 ladies on the street, one of them for sure will have breast cancer in a lifetime. That's the statistic. 15% of the Jewish ladies in the world are barren. Almost every family has 1 patient with cancer. Number 1 in the world. It's already more than heart attacks, cancer. Almost every family. In Israel, almost every family has 1 or 2 or 3 soldiers that died over the years in wars and terrorism. So much agony, so much pain. For what? If the purpose of life was to enjoy here, we wouldn't have all this. That's enjoyment. Even the richest guy in the world still have to go to war, still have to sit in meeting, still have to worry, to pay employees, to fire, to inventory, people stealing from me. That's not pleasure. And you see that even physical pleasure, it's only a temporary pleasure. A week later, you cannot stand it anymore. You eat steaks. How many steaks you can eat? You go on a place to vacation, 1, 2, 3 times, you don't want to go there anymore. The pleasure is never perfect. Even people, they marry 6 months, they don't want their wives anymore. They begin to search for other girls. Why? It's getting tired for this pleasure. That's it, I had it. It's not perfect. God, when God does something, it's perfect. The reward is perfect. If this was the place of life, the Ramchal says, why so many people are suffering? So the answer is to finish, and then we read a little bit for the Chanukat Bayit, 10 minutes, and we'll finish for tonight. Just remember one thing from this lecture. You have the DVDs, I didn't want to give too many proofs, you have everything here. I speak about the difference between us, the Goyim, the Torah and other religions, Mount Sinai, did it really happen? How do you know scientifically that the Jews heard God? How do you know that the Gemara is divine? Not only the Torah, the Gemara also, the Oral Torah. And what does God want from us? That's the last hour. What do I do here? What do I live for? What is everything that God says in the Torah combined to 1 hour and 15 minutes in the third chapter of this movie? Finally, for a Jew to realize, what is he doing here? And I get tons of response, email from all over. It's growing by the minute. like an epidemic. You know how it goes fast? You give few thousand DVDs, you have thousands of people already reacting. It goes into the email, they walk forward, it goes. Why? The Torah is the best product in history. The best. Every person that asking himself, what am I doing here? This is the answer for him. Right after he sees it, he says, hey, wait a minute. I wasted already 50 years. I might as well wake up for my last 10, 20 years. For I'm going to lose everything. As long as you're alive, you can correct. Once you died, you died. I'll tell you one last story for the end of the night. In Cincinnati, you have a rabbi called Rabbi Silver. One time you see a Jew comes to him. He's not religious. He takes a white yarmulke, he puts on his head, he sits in a Shabbat in a synagogue with his friend. But when they pray, he saw that this old man, about 60, 70 years old, he knows how to pray. You know, he goes three steps. He knows how to pray. He came to him and said, Good Shabbos, Good Shabbos. He saw his Yiddish accent. He said, where are you from? He told him, you know, I see that you know religion. Yeah, I used to be religious when I was young. What happened? He said, I'm from the camp. I'm a survivor. After what I've seen there, I decided it's not for me. So he told him, give me the real reason. Why? When it happened. He said, you see, we were standing for 17 hours in the sun like this all day, every day, from morning to night, going like this. Everyone who moves a little bit, boom, they shoot him, he dies. You cannot look. Stand like this all day, like every day like this. This is our life. One time my friend says to me, Fischel, 5 minutes before sunset, 5 minutes. So he's whispering to me. I said, no, 5 minutes, sunset, what? So we didn't put tefillin yet. 5 minutes is going to be light and night. We can't put tefillin. We didn't have time all day to put tefillin. This is the way we were over there. But we had this life. Until, guess what I saw, he told the Rav. We used to come 5 o'clock in the morning before they come to count us. Few minutes before they come, we're already standing in freezing weather. And remember, we didn't have what to wear, nothing. We're dying over there. One guy had a pair of tefillin. One! In the entire camp. And everyone fight for a piece of bread over there. It's like a treasure. He never let anybody put tefillin for free. You have to pay him. What do you pay him? You have to give him either a piece of bread or a cigarette, or anything, potato, whatever you can get, you have to give it to him. If not, he doesn't let you put tefillin. One guy comes and beg him, I gave you everything I had, nothing left. Let me put tefillin, I don't have. If I had, I give it to you. I gave you everything I had. No, no money, no tefillin. So I saw that religion is all business. I swore to myself that moment, that's it, I'm done with this. If this is the way the religious people are, this guy, what he's doing to us, I don't want to be a part of it. And since then, I left everything. So Rabbi Silver told him, your ears should listen to your foolish mouth, what you're saying. Hundreds of Jews sacrificed the last piece of bread at the head, potato, life and death, not to miss one day of tefillin. Even though they didn't have to put. According to the Torah, you are not guilty. Cannot put, you're not guilty. You're in jail, you don't have tefillin. You're patur, no punishment. They didn't have to. If the Nazi come and see them standing there online, in 1 second they all be killed. But they didn't want to go one day in their life without putting tefillin. So from them, from all these kosher, righteous Jews, you didn't learn anything. You chose one wicked, evil person, and you decided to use him as your role model, and you left the truth, and you missed your whole life because of him. Why are you such a fool? So this guy got this shock of his life. He started to cry in front of all the people in the shul. He's crying. I guess the frustration of all the ears started to come out and say, right, it's all an excuse. He made tshuva, Baruch Hashem became a tzaddik. He got lucky, How many of them died already? They didn't make tshuva. Suffer so much in the Holocaust and in the end died as Mechalel Shabbat. You understand the problem here? Ignorance, not thinking, not reading, not watching around what's going on around me. This is very bad. The situation now in Israel with the Arabs. Look how much weapon they prepared in few years since Shimon Peres and Rabin brought them from Tunisia to Gaza. In 10 years they made in a little Iran inside Israel. Think about it. Think about a place the size of half of Brooklyn, under the ground, thousands of rockets, missiles, weapons, machine guns, teaching children 4, 5, 6 years old to shoot guns, screaming, burning it, inside! It's like from here to Queens, not even, what? It's 2 miles, 3 miles away, you're already there. And in Lebanon, the entire Lebanon is full of weapons and missiles. Can reach every corner in Israel. Every second that we live is a huge miracle. People are blind. Just think, 2.5 weeks, we in a war inside neighborhoods, one house is on top of the other. We should have 200-300 dead soldiers already. How many we had? 6, 7? All of them died from Israelis, except one. 2.5 weeks, thousands of armed terrorists that practice from morning to night, preparing us all kinds of bombs with wires, with laser, that you just go into the building. 100 should die, should collapse. One soldier they shot, took his head out of the tank, he got a bullet, and all this war, all the other soldiers Israeli killed them. Accidents. You ever thought such a thing could happen in a history? A war, 2.5 weeks? You don't know the place. Basement here, a secret door here, inside closet. Just think about it. You go into someone's house, you have to find them. Where do you know where he is? It's almost a guaranteed death. Chas v'shalom, I was afraid that every 5 minutes we're going to hear another one, 2 died, 3 died, 5 died, 15 died. They shot thousands of rockets. They didn't even kill 10 people. Thousands of rockets, thousands. You know what a rocket is? Boom, the whole ceiling collapsed. One fell in a school. Few hours before, they decided not to open the school that day. Hundreds of kids would die. The whole ceiling fell, but they decided to take a day off. So many miracles, but they don't see. That's what the Torah says, "Einayim lahem velo yiru." Where was God in the Holocaust? There's a whole vision, a whole prophecy about the Holocaust in the Torah. What is the question? It's not a legitimate question. Torah says, if you leave me, if you become like the Goyim, I don't need you here. 80% of the Ashkenazim in Europe became like the Goyim. It's not a lie. They're not denying it. They changed their names. They took the yarmulke off, they drove on Shabbat, they opened their businesses, they went to colleges in Germany. They didn't keep anything, no Torah, nothing. No beards, no nothing. They married a goyim. What does Hashem need you for? To be a monkey, just to eat and to sleep? What for? So you know what, I'll make you a favor. I'll start a new world. But they don't see it. It's inside the Torah. And inside the place the Torah says, Hashem says, I'm going to close my eyes and not watch over you, the word Holocaust appear in equal mathematical skip inside. The Holocaust. Adolf Hitler, equal skip. Adolf Eichmann, the same page, equal skip. The final solution, equal skip. Cyclone B, equal skip. More than 30 words about the Holocaust, Rudolf Hess, equal skip. In where? In the only place in the Torah that describes a Holocaust. And the Torah said the answer. If you rebel against me, why should I continue to help you? For what? I'm not interested that you be another Chris. I'm not interested. You want to be Chris. You want to live like a goy. You're embarrassed to be my son, to represent me. I don't really need you here. You break the covenant. But with his mercy, we're still breathing. We're still eating. Eat not kosher. Don't say bracha, still in a business, don't keep Shabbat, beat up his wife, terrible father to his children, and make millions. And then in the end he say, where is God? You understand? That's it. If a person just stops for 1 minute a day to review his day, how many miracles happen every second? A person will be crazy. Why God is doing so much for me? Who says that I have to have a house? Who said that I have to have steaks in my freezer? Who say I have to have nice chandeliers? Who say I have to have 2 cars in the driveway? Who say I have to have 5 watches in a safe and 20 suits in a closet? Who? I take it for granted. When does a person realize how much Hashem does for him when Hashem takes it away from him? That's what Hashem does to all the rich people now. There's almost no wealthy Jew in the world today that doesn't suffer in the last few months. Many billionaires lost everything. In short few weeks, all the billionaires in Israel, with no exception, all of them went bankrupt. I don't know if you know the news. All of them. The owner of Discount Bank, Recanati, Chapter 11. Yuli Ofer, the biggest tycoon in real estate, yesterday they announced he's bankrupt. Lebayov, bankrupt, sold his house in London, he cannot pay the banks. Sherry Harrison lost $1 billion in her cruise company, and the Bank of Poalim, without the government help, they don't know what's going to be. Guy Damak, that gave $500,000 a day for weeks in the previous wars to the people to do camping out of the missiles range, went bankrupt. 20 billionaires they had in Israel. It's not America. They're all bankrupt. Coincidence? All the yeshivot now in the world, Hashem said, I'm going to teach you a lesson. You want to learn Torah, you're going to have to do it in the right way. Not cigarette, coffee, cell phone, $5,000 suit, gel in your hair, things like you, Mr. Italian. I'm not interested in this kind of Torah. I'm interested in Torah like the other generation. 50 years ago, you know how people used to learn Torah? If you know the difference, you wouldn't believe. Hashem said, okay, time to choke everyone. The rich, the poor, the wicked, the righteous. Everyone is getting choked now. Missiles all over Israel. Jews here would be afraid to walk with the yarmulke, with the anti-Semitism here. Look, see the business already. How many comments they make against us in the internet every day. They clean everything, Fox News. They clean. But they miss 1% of the messages they miss. Hundreds of messages every week on Fox News. Get rid of the Jews. They bought all the problems. This is how it started in Germany. You think now, okay, you know what? I have a few million dollars. Let me take it. Fine, okay, so I won't be the billionaire I was dreaming about. Let me sell the house or the 2 houses. Sell the car. I have cash. I wire it to Israel. I go. I buy myself a beautiful house for $1 million. I live like a king. You don't have where to go. Everywhere in Israel, it's not safe now. The next thing, you get a missile on your head. Arabs everywhere. You think, okay, maybe I'll go to France. Arabs took over. England, Arabs took over. Where are you going to run? Canada, big recession over there. I spoke to someone today, everything is dead. So I might as well stay here. What? Over there, it's more antiseptic. There's nowhere to run. Hashem say, you cannot run away from me. There's no way to run. What's the only way Torah says? Who's going to get saved in the time of Mashiach? Someone that has Torah and kindness, chesed, helping others, caring for the others. And the biggest kindness between one Jew to the other is to make them religious, to give them free DVDs. You see? $1 cost to make, with the printing, everything. People donate. I'm not a rich guy. Can't pay thousands of discs every month to pay on my own pocket. But I don't want to make profit from this. Whatever it costs, that's what we give. And we gave already more than 12,000, 13,000 already in the last month and a half. Baruch Hashem, in such terrible time, in the old days, in one phone call, I would raise so much money. But now we had to sweat a lot. But everyone who donated, even small people, 100, 150, 500, 300, 20, 40, it adds up. It's travel from many hands. He goes home, he watches with his wife, children, his son, his girlfriend, the neighbor, his cousin, his uncle. He has a party, he puts it. Then the people go from here, they go into the internet, into the website. 400 lectures over there. And he forwarded it to hundreds of people. This $1 traveled for years and saved souls. You come to Olam Haba, Hashem say to you, what a lucky guy you are. You have trillions of mitzvot. Me? Trillions of mitzvot? I didn't make one mitzvah a day in my life. You joking with me? No. Here you go. You don't need 1,000 DVDs? Let's see where they travel. Get here, get there. I went to a big organization in Israel. It's called Idabrut. Everybody knows them. The biggest in the world today. For Kiruv, for Tshuva, the vice president saw me, runs. Nice to meet you. Yeah, I'm the vice president. Yeah, I came to meet you. I didn't know who he is. I'm here thanks to you. Thanks to me, I never saw you. Yeah, you didn't see me, but I saw you in the first movie. Changed my whole life. Became the vice president. 17 family members. Family called Shammai. I say the name, you can go. 17 became religious, one after the other, the parents, the brother, the sister, the kids, everyone from $1, $2. So the dollar doesn't have any value, it's true. But even with the dollar, you can save souls. Nah, it's much better than saving a body. If a soldier got wounded, and he's, let's say, 40 years old, and you saved his life, how great you're going to feel all your life? Thanks to me, this guy is alive. That's nothing compared to saving his soul. Because if you got him saved, all right, he's going to live another 30 years. He's going to die in the end. But if you save his soul, him, his children, his grandchildren, forever, every mitzvah they do, they go to your account. Since we are not doing so many mitzvot, we might as well know how to invest our money. Because people invest in millions of dollars in synagogues that we don't need. We have plenty of synagogues. Half of them is all empty. Hardly minyan they have. You come to all these fancy buildings everywhere I go, you want to daven mincha, 12 people you don't have. The chandelier, $2 million over there in the place. For what? What do we need such Italian imported marbles? Hashem cannot hear us on the wood floor. He cannot hear us in a small synagogue. Why do we need all these trillions of dollars that we wasted for no reason? If we would invest this money right, every Jew in the world will be religious today almost. Because Jews, I told you, they are not evil. They're just ignorant. And the same way you see today so many Baalei Tshuva, when you used to see them 10 years ago, you didn't want to stand next to them. What a rasha, wicked guy. Don't stand next to him. I don't want to be around you. Go away. But now he's a rabbi. That shows that he was never evil. He was just ignorant, the poor guy. You know how many innocent people I speak to them 10 minutes? Wow, I didn't know this. How come? Where can I get more information? Here is my card. Go to the website. 2-3 days later, it's always, constantly, every minute, like this. Come, go into the website. Go into the website. 3 days later, I already watched 9 lectures. Baruch Hashem, where do I buy more books? Here on the way, my friend can tell you. On the way, from Canada, from Toronto, phone calls. I want to buy more books. Where can I go to learn? Where I'm living in this area. There's no Jewish, no synagogues. What's going to be? Soon it's going to be holidays. I'm a doctor. I want to close my office, but everyone is going. Just found out the Torah a month ago. I already think what's going to happen in a holiday. He wants to close his businesses. Why? $1. The travels. This is it. People don't realize. They don't understand. Rabbi Amnon Yitzchak became what he is thanks to the DVDs. If he would work a million years without the DVD, he wouldn't become what he is. What made him is few million dollars that he spent with the help of the people on DVDs. And that's why he was able to bring 10,000 people to hear him. Without the DVD, who would know who he is b'chlal in America or in Israel? Know how many people you have to go to meet them until you finally meet a million people? Invest few million dollars in DVDs, website, phone calls, this, sharing for free to everyone. The whole world knows who he is. Everybody knows. They made rules against him in the Knesset. They made a rule that he's not allowed to enter military bases. Because everywhere he goes, half of the people become religious. Defeats their purpose. They don't want a religious army. They want to learn Torah and pray 2 hours a day. They want soldiers that wake up in the morning, they're already with a gun. They don't want, Rabbi, give us an hour to pray. Give us an hour to learn. The army is not interested. I was in the army. I know what's going on over there. But believe me, it's in our hands. First, of course, you have to worry about your own soul. You, your wife, your children, your parents, your brother. This is the people you have to target. You're done with them. You go to other people that you don't know. Call Israel, Arevim Zelazeh. Thank you very much.